Good morning, all of you. We have been meeting the last 4 days, and we have gone through certain exercises which are called review exercises, reviewing our own work, having an opportunity to present our work and also to listen to others about their perceptions and their perhaps perspectives onto our work. So that opportunity gave us certain objectivity to present oneself before an audience. It also gave us a detachment which allowed us the patience to listen to certain suggestions, maybe a critical approach to how we are doing things from the experts. And this is in short called the philosophical method. The ability to articulate our arguments, our position in a clear manner with detachment and objectivity. And also listen to certain critical evaluation of what we are doing, how we are doing, and whether we are doing it through the right method is also part of philosophical reflection. So essentially what we did in the last 4 days can be described as philosophical reflection. Keeping that in mind, today we are exclusively discussing on critical inquiry and methods in philosophy. So one might debate whether the whole idea of method is unique to philosophy. That has to be again understood from various perspectives of people sitting here, but at least we have no doubt that what we call as critical inquiry essentially requires a philosophical bent of mind, which means a huge amount of conceptual clarity. Unless there is a conceptual clarity, there is no scope for interpretation. Interpreting other texts and also the texts which we are weaving day in and day out for our work, because we are all producing discourses. That discourse already is, in a certain sense, colored or biased because of our own personhood interpreting it. So this has been a big debate in philosophy, whether the subject-object can be together, be present together, or they will have to be taking their path apart. So this debate continues to happen today, and that has a history with both in the East and the West. And of various forms, you would see the subject-object divide and debate. Primarily, what it means is what we call as pure objectivity, is it possible? And number two is pure subjectivity, is it possible? And if you extend the second argument and take it into the context of what we today understand from the framework of humanistic psychology or positive psychology, a pure subjectivity, is it something which leads to alienation, inability to have social connect, inability to articulate in such a manner that there is empathy in your arguments, so that you also think of the other person, the audience, or the reader, or the listener, while you formulate your argument? Because formulation of arguments itself needs a lot of empathic skills. And without empathic skills, philosophy always, or most often, can deteriorate to what psychology calls as a narcissistic engagement. So you're engaging with yourself, or you're engaging with a certain kind of data or knowledge which you think you possess, and you're articulating it. So you can see that philosophy is not at all an abstract exercise. It is the most engaging exercise, which gives us the challenge of bringing in objectivity without losing the flavor and richness of the subject one is. So the whole idea of philosophy is not to get rid of subjectivity or the subject and move on to certain sense of or certain technique of objectivity, which of course science praises enough. But the idea of philosophy is first is critical inquiry. And this inquiry is not only in terms of looking at the method of philosophy, but also is to look at the engagement. And often we have to understand engagement in terms of our inclusive space. Who are the stakeholders included in a particular philosophical exercise. That is why a philosophical exercise is also very important to understand social forces, social structures. So Marx, Nietzsche, Schopenhauer in the West, and here Yajnavalkya, Gautama, of course Shankaracharya, and many other philosophers, even contemporary philosophers like Ramana Maharshi, engaged in such an exercise to see how alienated your subject is, or do we distinguish between what can be labeled as alienation of subject from the engagement of the person into it. Because alienation of subject leads also to a very colorless, orderless, and most importantly, irresponsible making of arguments and conclusions. And living in a society which is pluralistic, dynamic, and also with multiple stakeholders, I feel that, as a philosopher, I feel that our arguments have to be placed in a social context, and therefore more important would be responsibility in multiple levels, which includes moral responsibility, academic responsibility, and primarily responsibility to oneself in terms of one's growth, one's development, and the ability to reach across multiple audiences. So with this in background, we will have this discussion, and please believe me that we are all philosophers, and that is the beauty of philosophy. In spite of a training required for philosophical exercise, perhaps in an academic context, the very act of thinking and the right ways of thinking, or at least the ability to think that there could be a right way of thinking, makes us a philosopher. So philosophy is a meta-exercise in thinking by being in your being. Sorry, I'm getting too philosophical here, but the second B is a capital B. So with this in background, we will engage in this discussion. It's a beautiful discussion, it's a beautiful morning, and I think it's a beautiful occasion here at NIAS. At the end of this 4 days, a lot of discussion, we have settled in a reflective space, and this is the right moment to talk about this topic. So we have Professor Sreekumar Nellickappily on my left, and he's a well-known philosopher and engaged in a lot of multidisciplinary work, including medical ethics, and also trained in what is called as Western methodology in philosophy. And to my right is a Sanskritic scholar, Prof Sachchidananda Mishra, who has also excelled in particularly in texts in Sangha Yoga, Nyaya, and so on. So for everything, we need a structure. So without structure, we cannot include everyone. So in order to have an inclusion of everyone, we will follow a structure. So I would request Prof Sreekumar to make his opening remarks, perhaps not more than 10 minutes. I hope I didn't take more than 10 minutes. So not more than 10 minutes. And thereafter, I will ask Prof. Sachchidananda to make comments for not more than 10 minutes. Thereafter, I will ask Dr. Saurabh Todaria to make a few comments, and then Dr. Shankar. And then I think we will all engage it in terms of questions or answers. We'll come back to it as it is. So there will be quite a bit of spontaneity. So please don't rehearse your questions in your mind. Please be in the space. Because if you rehearse your questions, you're not listening to what's happening. And philosophy is primarily being in the present. When you are in the present, the past and the future will be blessing you. So with those remarks, may I request Professor Sreekumar to make his comments.
Thank you, Sangeetha. And I also take this opportunity to thank all of you, particularly my friend Professor Sangeetha Menon, for inviting me here. Because as she said, today is the concluding day, at least for me. Many of you will be staying, all of you will be staying back, but I'll be leaving for the time being. Okay, we'll be meeting again. So this is a nice topic to conclude with, critical thinking. Yesterday we had a brief introduction about this. So it's a nice continuation that we'll begin with that. I was actually thinking about Indian philosophy, particularly when Professor Mishra said he reminded us about the idea of Purva Paksha. And of course, whenever I see an Indian philosopher, this is what comes to my mind, the idea of Purva Paksha, which is very, very, very unique. I won't say very unique, very important as far as Indian philosophical traditions are concerned. But today, in this 10 minutes, what I'll try to do is that I'll focus more on Western thought, because today we are working in a global environment. Our works, I mean, whatever academics we do, we are trying to communicate with, I think most of the universities, the Scopus indexed publications have become mandatory, which means that you have to communicate with an international audience, not with your Indian peers. Okay, so in that sense, we have to speak in a language which others will understand. I will begin with the European thought, and probably we'll have a conclusion of this sometime later, because I don't think we'll get time for that. But there are questions like, what is critical thinking? And there are, of course, different answers to this question. One may find very different answers, but all of us would agree that, it has something to do with rational thinking. Like religious thinking, for example, a religious person, we don't really consider that, critical thinking has a very important role when it comes to the life of a religious person. Okay, not that a religious person is not critical, but at least when that particular activity is carried out. But again, another question at the other extreme is that do you mean that by being critical, you have to be completely impartial, non-partisan to any particular set of ideas? I would say no, because there again, not always. There are different traditions or different frameworks which from where we can derive this notion of critical ideas, about critical thinking, and how we understand this this concept by situating it in philosophical thinking, contemporary philosophical thinking. So I'll begin with, I'll begin with Socrates. And all of us, all of you would have heard about him, and he is the darling of all philosophical, all students of philosophy, because, there is a question which, the story, the Oracle of Delphi was asked about who is the wisest among all the Greeks, and the answer was, it is Socrates. And Socrates was also sort of bewildered, because he was also wondering why, because I never knew that I am the wisest, and why do they call me wisest, because I know that I do not know anything. Still they call me the wisest. Then he concludes, yes, that's precisely, there lies the key. I know that I do not know anything. So the very acknowledgement that you know very little, or your ignorance, the acknowledgement of your ignorance is probably the starting point of philosophical reflections or philosophical wisdom. So I would rather say that this is the key to the Socratic idea of critical thinking as well, because we could see Socrates in the writings of Plato and some other writings, that Socrates is continuously, persistently engaged in conversation, in dialogue with other people. And another very important aspect of Socratic thinking is that you won't find Socrates in a classroom. It's not an academic philosophy. You would find him in the marketplace, in marriage ceremonies, where common people, men and women, do go for their day-to-day activities. And there he engages in conversation with people. And in this conversation, though the Platonic account of this conversation occasionally projects him as the master of the whole debate, we could also find that Socrates begins with a very genuine acknowledgement of ignorance. He actually doesn't know. I mean, he's also curious to know. So curiosity is very important. Okay, and the genuine willingness to admit one's ignorance, and the willingness to question oneself, willingness to question other people, others, willingness to question anything which is handed down to you, all these are, projected as the defining features of critical thinking in the Socratic tradition. So Socrates often calls himself as a gadfly, and you know the meaning of a gadfly. What the gadfly does is that when the horse tries to, horse will sleep when it stands, okay, and when it closes its eyes, the fly will come and disturb its and then it never allows the horse to settle down. So a critical thinker would never allow you to settle down in your ideas. It would always want you to question further, question again and again. Never settle, never be comfortable in your intellectual world. If you are, the moment you think that you are right, you are comfortably right, you have arrived the destination, then probably that is the end of critical philosophical thinking. So you have to keep on pursuing this endeavor of critical thinking, putting yourself in doubt, putting every idea that come to you in doubt. And so all kinds of, quote-unquote, false comforts have to be challenged and persistently questioned and be unsettled. But when you come to the Middle Ages, what you find is that the Catholic Church has its doctrine imposed upon almost the entire Europe was under the control. All departments of life, all institutions in Europe was under the control of Catholic rule. And they controlled everything. They controlled thinking, they controlled religious life, they controlled political life, everything. So people have to, there is no scope for, there is no need for critical thinking. You just have to accept the creed. And you could see that, you know, this is what people call 1,000 years, more than 1,000 years of dark ages. Nothing has happened. Okay, you just have to, everything pronounced by the church has a didactic value, and you have to just accept that. And the emphasis was on the communion of the God, where you have to be part of a community which advocates a common principle, a set of common principles. And you could see that towards the end of this period, what puts this period to an end is the Protestant movement. The very title itself is very interesting, Protestant movement, you know. And Protestantism originated from within the church itself. A group of priests have given rise to this. And when Martin Luther comes, you know, he comes with a very strong argument. He comes with the idea that the church has hardly any role. The church is not necessarily a mediator between the Bible and the devotee, the man, the individual and the Bible. Between the individual and the Bible, you don't need church to mediate. You can directly access the truth that is pronounced in the Bible. So truth and knowledge can be directly accessed. This is a very interesting notion, because when you say that it can be directly accessed, it presupposes that there is an individual, not a community, but an individual mind with a certain ability of rational critical thinking, which can access the truth individually, directly. So this is, in one sense, you know, you can see that this is the emergence of, you could see the emergence of individualism in, I'm just trying to very summarize this, because, you know, there is no, many more minutes left?
I lost track.
Okay, I'll just conclude, try to conclude in less than 5 minutes. So what you come across here is that with the emergence of Protestantism, this individual mind, the critical, rational individual mind also takes birth. And there is one important philosopher who, in this 18th century thinker, whose name, we can't afford to not mention his name. It is Immanuel Kant. Because whenever you talk about critiquing, the very idea of critiquing, we associate it with the works of Immanuel Kant, who has written three monumental critics: critic of pure reason, critic of practical reason, and critic of aesthetic judgment, covering three important concerns of philosophical thinking. Pure reason with epistemology and knowledge and rational thinking, practical reason with deliberations on the good, ethics, and morality, and judgment on aesthetics, the experience of beauty. So all the important aspects of philosophical thinking, critical thinking, can be critiqued. This is what the idea of critique critiquing which Kant was trying to advocate. And what Kant means by critiquing is that, you know, you make a, as Sangeetha was mentioning it, you are actually turning your, philosophers normally what they do is that it's like the camera, they turn towards the world. The eye is towards the world and try to get themselves separated from the world and try to see the world, an objective gaze on the world, okay? So this is what the camera does. So philosophers also used to do that, but now philosophers started turning the camera to themselves. And the mind is a camera, okay? Your mind is a camera. Now the mind is turning its gaze towards itself. So this is critiquing. So it's not just critically trying to understand others, but also endeavoring for a self-critique, turning the gaze towards oneself. So this is what Kant means by transcendental critiques. Okay, so when you talk about critical thinking, this is very important phase. No, but there is a problem with this Kantian assumption. Kant assumes that the mind can actually do this, that look at the world from a very objective perspective and look at oneself, one's own ability, one's own faculties of looking at one's own faculties of looking from a objective platform, which is highly doubtful. Whether this could be done or not is a very highly doubtful thing. This is what happens in the 20th century. By 20th century, philosophers have lost interest in this kind of a critical endeavor, and what they do is that they turn more towards language, the critique of language. So in Wittgenstein we'll find this, philosophy is a critique of language. In Wittgenstein, in his one of the most important works, philosophical works of 20th century, he mentions this. So philosophers are trying to sort of focus on language and whether linguistic expressions do what they were intended to do, or are they trying to sort of take us, linguistic expressions can create a lot of confusion in us. And this is a very interesting exercise. If you learn analytical philosophy, they have all kinds of, you know, works on this. Dr. G. Moore's work and many other philosophers have written a lot about this. And then, but what I'll try to conclude is that, I'll try to conclude with another alternative to this Kantian critical thinking, which was adopted by phenomenologist and hermeneutic tradition, where they were trying to go back to the Greek tradition and reinventing the Greeks. And the Greeks were strong in their ontology, while 17th century philosophers were strong in their epistemology. So the Greek philosophy was being reinvented by these thinkers, and critical thinking has been redefined in a different way. So in Gadamer's work, Hans-Georg Gadamer, the German philosopher, who's in his work, you will find that prejudices, normally, you know, we consider to be prejudiced as a wrong thing, as a negative thing. What he says is that to be prejudiced is not necessarily wrong, because we can't help it. We are always prejudiced. We can't help our prejudices. The moment when I say that I'm not prejudiced, that itself is a prejudicial statement. So what he says is that Enlightenment philosophy, 18th century Enlightenment philosophy, in the name of critical thinking, was rather projecting a kind of prejudice against prejudices. Okay, it's a prejudice against prejudices. So you have to actually go beyond that, or rather reinvent a different vocabulary for philosophy so that you can get rid of these issues and begin with the original problems in philosophy. So he goes back to the Socratic world, the spirit of the Socratic dialogue, where, you know, there is a genuine, as I began with, there is a genuine interest to know, to understand, to critically evaluate things and to acknowledge. I mean, it actually begins with the acknowledgement of ignorance. So Gadamer emphasizes on dialogue. So he says that every real knowledge, even critical thinking, can be embedded in a genuine dialogical process. And that's the only way we can solve our problems. Because philosophy has I mean, philosophical thinking is intended to take us to domains which probably we cannot articulate in clear terms. So I'll conclude with a story. There is a since she mentioned about Ramana Maharshi, I was reminded of this. There was a I'll conclude with this. It'll take hardly 1 minute. There was Ramana Maharshi has had several disciples all over the world. So they have all decided to celebrate his birthday, and they went and sought his permission. He said he was not very interested. He was totally disinterested. Whatever you want, you do it. So he sort of gave a silent permission for that. And it was a global event. They have invited scholars from different continents, particularly from China and Japan and other places. And there were about 300 delegates participating in the deliberations. And they were printing the notices, the brochures and all that. One day, Maharshi entered and he was just going around and seeing who are the speakers. So he found that, you know, there are 300 speakers. Oh, 300 speakers coming for deliberating about my philosophy. And what is my philosophy? About silence. So philosophy also has to deal with silence. Okay, that's a very important domain. And I don't know what critical philosophy can really gain that. It is definitely self-critiquing. So all criticism is, sorry, not criticism. All critiquing is self-critiquing. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Sreekumar. That last story of silence almost gave me a tear in my eyes, and thinking, you know, that we live in a world today which is bombarded with words of different kinds. If only we could spend much silence inside and outside and in between also, we would have been perhaps better people. The world we live in would have been better place. But then at any case today, I think we may have to engage in with a few more words. So I would request Professor Sachchidananda Mishra to make his remarks for another 10 minutes.
Namah sabhabhyah sabhapati bhyascha namo namah. First, I would like to thank Professor Sangeetha Menon for inviting me to this brainstorming session. And without spending much time, I come to the topic, what is critical thinking or what is critical inquiry? There are many ways in Indian philosophy. One way of critical inquiry is propounded by NIAS philosophy. Another is Mimamsa. Another one is Nagarjuna. And some more are there. But the time will not allow me to take all these positions together to discuss. So I will limit myself only to NIAS position. According to NIAS, and when Gautama propounded NIAS philosophy, actually he not only propounded NIAS philosophy, but also a way of inquiry, way of critical inquiry. And according to Gautama, critical inquiry is that kind of thinking where we begin with a doubt and reach at a conclusion. Beginning with a doubt and reaching at a conclusion. But there are also some steps which are made very clear how you could begin with a doubt and how you have to settle the question, how you have to remove the doubt. So to deal with this point, in first sutra, Gautam propounded 16 tattvas, and there are these 16 tattvas are actually making clear the process of inquiry and the process for a discussion. Because according to NIAS, there are two processes involved. One is self-inquiry. And another one, when we are engaged with someone else in a different kind, that is also a kind of inquiry. And that kind of inquiry is carried on some other grounds. So what is the way? I first repeat the first sutra. pramana prameya sanshaya prayojana drishtanta siddhanta avayava tarka nirnaya vad jalp vitanda hetvabhasa chal jati nigrahasthananam tatvagyanam nihshreya sadhigamah. This is the first sutra. And this sutra begins with pramana and prameya. And explaining pramana prameya first, and you can see all those things which are to be explained, these are included in these two tattvas, pramana and prameya. And actually, beginning with pramana is very much important for this reason, that there must be some grounds how you are beginning your inquiry. And in this case, Gautam says that there are four pramanas, pratyaksha, anuman, upamana and shabda. However, there is also a very important point to note that upamana and shabda pramana are not coming in this discussion completely in such a way as pratyaksha and anuman are coming. So most important process is anuman, inference. Therefore, this philosophy is known by a different name, anvikshiki. So, in anvikshiki, we begin with sanshaya and reach at nirnaya. Sanshaya is one tattva and nirnaya is another tattva. And in between them, there are certain tattvas. Sanshaya, prayojana, drishtanta, siddhanta, avayava, tarka and nirnaya. So, these are actually steps to reach at a conclusion. How could you reach at a conclusion beginning from doubt? There must be some prayojan. What is your prayojan? You have to explain what is your aim of this discussion. Drishtant, because whenever you are discussing, evaluating your position or objecting some other's position, there must be some drishtant, some example. Drishtant means examples. So taking examples, you are evaluating the positions, different positions. And drishtant, thereafter comes siddhant. And this siddhant, many times it appears, how could come there is a siddhant without reaching at a conclusion? Because siddhant is such kind of statement, such kind of concept, which you reach at. So, how Siddhant is here? The point is that you cannot revise, you cannot inquire without taking into consideration some ideas. So, there are different types of Siddhantas, Sarvatantra Siddhanta, Pratitantra Siddhanta. And Sarvatantra Siddhanta means there are some concepts which must be accepted by everybody. And if people are coming and they are of this opinion that you cannot reach at a conclusion, so what kind of discussion, what kind of inquiry could be carried on? There is no possibility of carrying on any kind of inquiry. So there must be some concepts, some agreements on the issue where you can begin with. So this is called Siddhanta. And here in Siddhanta, there are some very important concepts are taken as Abhyupagama Siddhanta and Adhikarana Siddhanta. These are very important topic concepts. Adhikarana Siddhanta is kind of Siddhanta which is coming at as a substratum. That means if you accept this concept, you are forced to accept some other concepts. That is called Adhikarana Siddhanta. And there is another concept which is known as Abhyupagama Siddhanta. Let us, Abhyupagama Siddhanta means accepting a concept without any inquiry. For inquiry, you are accepting some concept in that way. Okay, let us suppose your position is true. What will be the result? What conclusion we could reach from that? Whether this is actually a kind of hypothesis. What we are talking about in scientific inquiry, scientific hypothesis is taken to be a kind of Abhyupagama Siddhanta. Because it was propounded first, thereafter it is tested. So that kind of, and here you take a concept to test it, whether it is able to defend its own objections. This is called Abhyupagama Siddhanta. So you take some concepts, some siddhantas, abhyobhagama siddhanta and adhikarana siddhanta. So this adhikarana siddhanta, when you have taken one adhikarana siddhanta, you cannot go in a different direction. You are bound to follow the same direction because your adhikarana siddhanta will not allow you to go in a different direction. And abhyobhagama siddhanta is such kind of siddhanta which is propounded and thereafter it is accepted only for evaluation. And after evaluation, this concept, this siddhanta is not standing, then we have to leave it. And we have to modify our own positions. We have to take a different concept, reach at a different solution, different conclusion. So, siddhanta, avayava, and there are avayavas. Avayava means there are some five sentences, and these five sentences are spoken to prove and in formulated to establish a position. And there are pratigya, hetu, udaharana, upanaya, and nigaman. These are five type of, and I think the students of philosophy are very much aware of these concepts. I am not going to discuss and explain those ideas. So avayava, and there is also another thing, tarka. Tarka is very important here. Tarka in nyaya, it is not a pramana. It is not a pramana, but it is a pramana nugrahaka. If we take the term here, it helps at reaching at a conclusion. It is not giving you, it is not actually providing you a conclusion, but only helping you reach at a conclusion. This is to say, it has a purpose of reviewing, refuting other positions. There are many options available, and if some options are removed, then one option which is not removed, which is not negated by any tarka, then that position is accepted. So in this way, beginning from sanshaya, beginning from doubt, we reach at a conclusion. And whenever there is a doubt, there are simply two ways, two positions at least must be there. And because if there is only one position, there cannot be a doubt. So two positions must be there. And if one is negated by a tarka, then another must be accepted. So this is a way in which Gautam propounded a framework for critical inquiry and critical thinking. So this was a framework for when you are engaging yourself in a self-inquiry without taking any help of someone else. And when you are engaged in an inquiry, taking help of someone else, that process is taken as a kind of vada. And this is a vada jalpa vitanda hetva bhas chala jati nigrahasthan concepts are there. And in vada, two people are there and both are having opposite positions. They are not, this is not the case that both of them are having the same position. If a nayayik is there and another nayayik is there and both of them are sitting together and evaluating, this is not the case. But they must have different opinions. And having different opinion, but always they must be open to their, open to correction. They must accept their faults. So that is called vada, and without going into much detail of that, vada, jalpa, vidanda. Jalp is something different where you engage in a dialogue only to refute the opponent's position. And vitanda is a different type of dialogue where you engage yourself in an argumentation where your aim is not to prove anything, but your aim is only to disprove the opponent's position. So vada jalpa vitanda. So it is explanation how there could be a dialogue. There are different ways in which you can engage yourself in to reach at a conclusion, and in order to reach at a conclusion, vada type of katha is accepted. So this is the way, according to Gautam, critical inquiry should be carried on. Thank you very much. I hope I have not taken much time.
you so much, Professor Mishra. I think now we will go to Dr. Saurabh Todaria, who is also quite, trained himself in philosophy and acquainted with philosophical method. So, Dr. Saurabh.
So first, I would like to thank Professor Sangeetha Menon to give me the opportunity to part of the distinguished panel. So what I have just some tentative ideas in my mind, which I hope that get clarified during the course of our discussion and the brainstorming session. So I would like to highlight, as we are talking about the method, so what is the relationship between the method and the aim? So like scientific method, when we talk about the scientific method, so scientific method has come out because there is some aim of the science, that there are some physical laws in the world which has to be understood through following the scientific methodology. Similar in the social sciences, the positivism is there, that there are some social laws are there which has to be unraveled through following the social science methodology. Positivism is there, and there is also interpretation, hermeneutic method is also there. So first question I would like to ask that what is the aim of philosophy? Because when we think about what is the aim of the philosophy, then accordingly we can think of about the method, and we can revise method as well. So like what I am going to submit that this issue of the method has become very central in the modern philosophy, especially with Descartes, because of course method was already there in the Greek philosophy, that were very implicit there, so dialectical and this critical method. But the method, because at that time the philosophy was so much influenced by the science and the European Renaissance, so method has become so central that what we call as a methodology, that without the proper methodology you cannot even enter into the proper inquiry. So we find Descartes is repudiating all kinds of the beliefs and coming up with the topic, I think, therefore I am. Similarly in Kant, when he starts his critique, he says, okay, critical philosophy is that first we have to revise the limits of the reason. Then we can only ask what are the legitimate questions, and we should repudiate the metaphysical questions. So, but what I think that modern philosophy, this emphasis on the methodology has done, that it has also removed some of the very important and the interesting, which has also brought by in the discussion by Professor Sreekumar also, that it has also removed, like in the Phaedrus, when Socrates talks about the madness. So he says the madness is also called as the divine madness, which also gives us a new kind of the ideas. And also when in Aristotle we find aim of the philosophy as the eudaimonia, excellence, and we find that Kierkegaard is also responding to this overarching rational philosophy that rather than the objectivity, the subjectivity is also truth. So these are the some concerns I would like to get clarified on, that what is the aim of the philosophy, accordingly we can think of the method. So one interesting philosopher which has spoken on against this so-called Western obsession with the rationality is Martin Heidegger, which is arguably the most influential 20th century philosopher. So he talks basically that philosophy, that the history of the Western philosophy, it has reduced everything into a representation. So everything has turned into the representation, and he says that height of it we see in the technology. So he's in the technology is basically reduce everything into a kind of that we can, it becomes the object of exploitation, object of interpretation. So he gives a kind of a new kind of, he says, how can we think of the philosophical problem in the non-representation and non-metaphysical way? So he gives the answer through the poetry, that through the poetry, through the silence, there is the possibility that we can, without reducing into the mysticism, we can still think of the philosophical problem. So that is what I would like to discuss with.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. We will now request Dr. Shankar to make his.
So my points will be in relation to poetry, because that is the field I am familiar with. as Sreekumar sir said, critical inquiry is an integral part of philosophy, and it's something that does not allow the mind to settle down. But the purpose of poetry, and when I say poetry, Indian poetry, specifically Sanskrit poetry, which I am familiar with, and Sanskrit poetics considers samvid vishranti as the ultimate purpose of experiencing poetry. So it does not allow the mind to be unsettled, rather it allows the mind to settle down in consciousness. So it's called as samvid vishranti. Samvid is consciousness and vishranti is settling down. So the repose of the mind within consciousness is the purpose of poetry, not to unsettle the mind, rather to settle it. A few more points on the method of poetry. Firstly, who is it that needs a method for poetry? So there are at least three people whom we could consider in the production, transmission and reception of poetry. There is the kavi or the poet, there is the sahridaya or the connoisseur, and there is the kavya shastrakara, who is the poetician. So the kavi is the poet who creates poetry, the sahridaya is one who enjoys poetry, and the kavya shastrakara or the poetician is someone who analyzes the components of poetry that make the sahridaya enjoy it. So the sahridaya has enjoyed a piece of poetry for some reason. There must be some components in that poetry which the connoisseur has enjoyed that makes him enjoy it. So a kavya shastrakara analyzes the components of poetry that makes the sahridaya enjoy it or not enjoy it also. So it is the kavya shastrakara comes only after the experience of the sahridaya. So it is the sahridaya's experience, it is the experience of the connoisseur based on which something is decided as worthwhile to be explored further. So poetry is considered as worthwhile to be explored further by the kavya shastrakara based on the experience of sahridaya. If the sahridaya gives a nod to a piece of poetry and says that it's a very good piece of poetry, then that is what the kavya shastrakara takes up for further analysis. And what does the kavya shastrakara actually do? The poetic flash, which we call as pratibha, that is responsible for the creation of poetry by the poet, and that is also the poetry that is enjoyed by the sahridaya. This enjoyment as well as the poetic flash are very instantaneous. They happen within a moment, and they are often experiential in nature. So this does not mean that the experience cannot be broken down into its parts, or that the experience lacks in its details. In fact, the experience is so compact and so quick that the details are not discernible. So the experience that the poet has during his poetic flash, or the experience of the sahridaya when he hears to a piece of poetry, is so quick that the details are not discernible. And what the kavya shastrakara does is to dissect these details. So to give an example, in the process of visual perception, when we perceive something visually, it is very instantaneous. But we know that the visual stimulus has passed through the retina, then through the optic nerve, then through the what we call as optic chiasma, then the optic tract, then the primary optic cortex, and then the secondary optic cortex. So there have been so many processes that have occurred from the time of being exposed to a stimulus and visually appreciating it. But it has been so instantaneous that we are not aware of those details. So in the same way, the experience of the sahridaya is so compact and so quick that he is not aware of the details. And similar is the case with the poet who composes poetry during a poetic flash. And what the kavya shastrakara does is to dissect out these details. So the kavya shastrakara actually is a post facto exercise for the kavya shastrakara. It happens after the experience has occurred. So analysis follows aesthetic experience, and aesthetic experience, most importantly, is not necessarily enhanced by analysis. Simply put, you don't enjoy a verse more the more you analyze it. Analysis happens after enjoyment, and analysis may not necessarily contribute towards enhancing this experience. Then why do we actually need a Kavya Shastrakara? It is enough if we have the Kavi as well as the Sahridaya. Why have a Kavya Shastrakara who analyzes this poetry after it has been enjoyed? And here we have the term Shastra. So Shastra is traditionally described as Shasana Shastra Muchyate. What is Shastra? That which does the activity of Shasana. And what is Shasana? Shasana is to understand and fix the limits of poetry here. So you understand what are the limits of poetry and you fix those limits. So you define what is poetry, for example, what is good poetry, what is bad poetry, what are the flaws in poetry, what are the merits in poetry, etc. And you fix the boundaries of poetry. In a way, this helps in critical evaluation of poetry. Not everyone in this tradition can claim to be a poet. And for example, you have this verse at the very beginning of Dhwanyaloka by a poet called Manoratha. And he criticizes people who appreciate poetry without understanding it. There is this particular concept called Dhwani in poetry. And he makes fun of people, this Manoratha, the poet makes fun of people who do not understand poetry and keep on shouting that there is so much of Dhwani, there is so much of suggestion in this poem. Kavyam tad dhvanina samanvitamiti pritya prashamsan jado. He calls such persons as jada, as foolish people who don't understand poetry, and the poetry that they appreciate actually has no merits at all. And such poetry, they say that it is replete with so much of suggestion. So it is necessary that poetry is also critically evaluated. And what Shastra does is give us the tools to critically evaluate poetry. So the method that is used by Shastrakaras, Kavya Shastrakaras, is usually a very simple method of Lakshana, Lakshya, and Lakshya Lakshana Samanvaya. So Lakshana is to define a concept, Lakshya is to provide an example to illustrate the concept, and Lakshana Samanvaya is to evaluate the appropriateness of this example. So whether the example actually correctly exemplifies the concept, correctly illustrates the concept. So let me give an example. At the very beginning of his Kavya Prakasha, Mammatta defines what is poem, what is poetry. So he calls poetry as tadadoshau shabdarthau saguna vanalankriti punakvapi. It is shabda and artha, word and meaning. Poetry is word and meaning. Adoshau, without any flaws. Sagunau, with several poetic merits. And analankriti punakvapi. Alankara is figures of speech. And he says that it is not necessary that poetry always has a figure of speech. It can sometimes, you could call something as poetry even if it is not alankrita, even if it is not embellished with several figures of speech. He not just gives this definition but also gives an example. And this example is by, this verse is by a poetess. Her name is Sheila Bhattarika, who is considered as a poetess of a very high degree and almost placed on the same level as the poet Banabhatta. And she has a verse. And this verse doesn't have any striking idea, but it conveys a particular experience. So when I say Alankara, it's a striking idea. And Mammatta says that it is not necessary that poetry always has a striking idea. Even if it communicates an experience which is likely to become a universal experience, even such poetry can be called as poetry. And he gives this example of a verse by Sheila Bhattarika. The verse is, Yah kaumarahara sayeva hivara stayeva chaitrakshapa techon milita malati surabaya prauda kadamba nila sachaivasmi tatapi chaurya surata vyapara lila vidau reva rodhasi vetasi tarutale chetas samutkantate. So this Sheila Bhattarika is telling about herself. She has loved somebody and she is getting betrothed to the same person. She is getting married to the same person. This is probably a verse that was written just on one day prior to her marriage. And she says, Yah Kaumara Haraha, that person who stole my childhood has become the groom to whom I'll be marrying. He is the same person who stole my childhood to whom I'll be married. Sayeva Varaha, Tayeva Chaitrakshapaha. It is spring now, and these are the nights of the spring. These are the same nights that I used to experience earlier. These are the same nights of spring that I experienced earlier. Techonmilita Malati Surabaya Prauda Kadamba Nila. This is the breeze from the Kadamba trees, and these are as fragrant as they used to be earlier. But there is one difference. I am not finding that excitement today, the excitement that I used to feel, that excitement I used to experience when I used to stealthily meet him on the bank of Narmada. She used to meet the same person hiding from others, and there was some excitement, an excitement that cannot be vocalized. There was some excitement that was there when she used to hide from others and meet him on the banks of Narmada. But now, that excitement is gone. Now she will be married to him, and there is no chance of hiding from others and meeting him. So that excitement is gone. So what she is conveying is some experience. There is no any striking idea here. But then, in spite of that, this is said to be a poem of a high order. And giving another, I shall also give another example and end with it. This is a verse from Kalidasa's Kumara Sambhava. The verse is, Evam Vadini Devarshau Parshve Pitur Adhomuki Leela Kamala Patrani Ganayamasa Parvati. So, a way a Sahridaya, a connoisseur will appreciate this, will be different than a way a poetician will analyze this verse. A connoisseur will experience it instantaneously, but however, the poetician has to dissect its components and put forth in front of us. So how a poetician would experience or dissect, analyze the same verse is what I shall be discussing. Narada, the divine sage, has come to Himavan, who is the father of Parvati. And Parvati is standing just by the side of her father. And Narada is recounting the various merits of Shiva. Shiva has several good qualities, which he is recounting in front of Himavan. Parvati already has set her heart on Shiva, and she wants to hear more and more about the good qualities of Shiva, whom she loves. And the poem is placed in this context. So when Narada was recounting the qualities of Shiva, what did Parvati do? Parvati was standing just by the side of Shiva, and she had bent her head down. And what she was doing, bending her head down, she had a lotus in her hands, and she was counting the petals of that lotus. So the verse is very simple. A Sahridaya would get lot of information, in fact, from this verse, but he will not be able to dissect this information separately. It will be presented to him as a very compact experience within which all these various components which the poetician will dissect are present. So what are those components? So firstly, there is the mental state of love, which has been enhanced because she is hearing to the qualities of Shiva. Then there is this intention, excitement to hear to them. She wants to hear to his qualities more and more. However, she cannot do it. She cannot raise her head and do this. If she raises her head, then her father or Narada would think that she is so immodest that she is directly listening to the qualities of the person whom she is going to marry. So that would not be possible for her. She cannot directly listen to, she cannot look at their faces and listen to what they are talking. So she has to feign modesty. So that is why she is bending her head down. But if she bends her head down, then again that is a cue that she likes Shiva. And she should not show her liking to Shiva in front of her elders. So she has to do something else for them not to know that she is actually set her heart on Shiva. Or she should not basically let out the information that she loves Shiva. So what she does is she bends her head and counts the petals of her lotus. So people will think she has bent her head for counting the lotus. They will also think that she is modest and that is why she has bent. But they will not, but she will also be there in the same place and she can listen to the qualities of Shiva recounted again and again. So all these various mental states, the mental states of state of love, the mental state of bashfulness, the mental state of utkantha, which is eagerness to hear to his qualities again and again, and the mental state of avahitta, which is to hide a mental state. So she is also hiding a mental state. So all these various mental states are being conveyed through this one simple verse. These mental states, when the Sahridaya hears to this verse, in his experience, all these information would have been there. But he cannot dissect these various mental states from this verse and put forth in front of the in front of us the way the poetician has done. So this is one of the methods of that the poeticians follow. I don't think that when these mental states are actually dissected and put forth in front of us, the excitement of the happiness that we experience on hearing to the verse becomes manifold. So that is why I made this comment that the more you analyze it, it doesn't mean that the more you enjoy the same verse. So with these comments, I stop.
Thank you, Dr. Shankar. I think in a span of perhaps roughly 45-50 minutes, we have had a very beautiful cross-section of how method is so diverse. And also, I think what Dr. Saurabh said, the method depends upon what you want to set upon as a goal. So that also is, I think, extremely important, which again shows that you cannot have a straitjacketed method for everything. It depends upon what is that which you want to investigate. And also, I think what Dr. Shankar said finally, at least in the context of poetry, that analysis per se need not give enjoyment to you. So that's why perhaps better enjoy the poetry and someone else will perhaps analyze and put together things, and why sacrifice that enjoyment. Well, in the context of poetry, perhaps that's right. And but perhaps in the context of just the sheer joy, because I am one of those people who gets that sheer joy when certain things are analyzed. Suddenly everything is clear, all the details are seen, and a holistic picture is get. So perhaps an analysis without an engagement with it and without placing yourself definitely can lead to boredom or disinterest and therefore non-enjoyment. But if you take enjoyment as also a result of participation and therefore engaging more and thereby expanding your own frame of knowledge, that I feel is a different dimension we need to look into. Professor Sreekumar presented before us an extremely wide scenario of method in Western philosophy and how it has evolved and perhaps also has showcased before us that the various ways philosophers experimented with method in the historical time. So now I won't take more time, but perhaps I hope you would have a few things to say. Or, of course, you can adopt the method of silence because Professor Sreekumar has already endorsed it in the beginning. But as we said in the start, at least the words are there in front of us as tools, and thoughts are there inside us as agents of inspiration. So if you use these two, silence can be produced even verbally.
That is Lakshya Lakshana Samandhi.
Yeah. So perhaps we can also engage in with silence using words. Yes, Siddharth. And everybody should take less than 5 minutes.
So my question is more sort of pragmatic in the sense. So Professor Sreekumar gave a very broad outline of what is the methodology of philosophy as such and as it has evolved in the history of Western philosophy. And Professor Mishra, you told us about how by methodology you interpret it as the epistemology of a particular school within Western, within Indian philosophy, Nyaya, and you similarly hinted that there are some, there are different, more different epistemic commitments of other schools such as say Mimamsa or the Buddhists. So, but if I were to take up a much smaller philosophical project, I mean more practically say a research project which is a doctoral project or even a particular small project which is going to come as a paper. So what is the methodology of my inquiry? I mean, this is a question that came up probably even earlier when I started my own PhD or something like that. So in such a context, does the methodology or does the question of what is the methodology always translate to what is the tradition you are going to operate within? Because it seems to me that whatever the methodology that is I'm following always falls within a particular kind of tradition which has its own epistemic commitments. So does that question sort of is that the way the question translates broadly? I mean, that is something that I've sort of thought through my PhD itself.
I would say that you allow the text in the sense not necessarily a particular text or a book or something. You must be starting with something, right? Some sort of a domain. You allow it to talk to yourself. Because, you know, if you start imposing your meanings on the text, I'm talking absolutely from a hermeneutic perspective. And I believe this is a very valid approach. I don't call it method. It's an approach. It's a very valid approach you can adopt. Let's not call it method, because method is a very confusing term, because method is a term which is rooted in the scientific tradition. And, you know, there are people like Feyerabend who have written books like Against Method. Okay. And even Gadamer's own book is Truth and Method. So let's call it approach. The approach is allow this domain to talk to yourself. Listen to that. I think this can happen only if you acknowledge your ignorance. Socratic. I think we have to learn a lot from Socrates as far as... and I believe that... I mean, I was also a little surprised because I'm not very well trained in the Indian thought when Professor Mishra said it rhymes quite well with these ideas, you know, because when he talks about how the Nyaya thinkers have developed that critical inquiry, the spirit of that critical inquiry, a detailed dissecting approach, you know, some very wonderfully sort of capturing the minute details of critical thinking. So all these are basically trying to say the same. You have to start with the idea that it tells you something, and try to listen to the text, try to listen to the domain without really imposing your meaning to that. Quite often we unknowingly do that. We try to impose, I mean, we go with certain four meanings. And as Heidegger says, you know, four structures of understanding are there. You don't have to really worry about them. Only thing is that you have to be aware of them, the four structures of understanding that constitute your starting point. So in a sense, you know, the text, you download the text to your context. In one sense, to use the modern contemporary terminology, you download the text to your context. And when you download it, it is a sort of, this is what the Greeks call aletheia. Okay, aletheia. Aletheia is unraveling. Okay, unfolding or unraveling or unconcealedness. Okay, something which is concealed to you. If you open your mind, if you open your eyes, then that will get unraveled. And next time when you go, again, certain other dimensions will get unraveled. So in that process, you get to engage in a dialogue with the text. I think that's very important, because we have to understand that basically only through dialogue we gain knowledge, or genuine knowledge and truth. Not with, even in the critical, what happens in critical inquiry is that if you think that critical inquiry is just to attack and have your point asserted, then you don't learn anything from the text. you don't move any one step forward. You stand in the same place and you demolish the text. You have got a wonderful opportunity to learn something from someone else, but you lost that opportunity. But if you allow that text to talk to you, so we'll go beyond what we see in Indian politics today, where people fight with each other, don't learn from each other. I think that should be the approach. Since you mentioned that, it's a very pragmatic concern for you. That is what I would say. Yeah.
My point was not completely understood, I think. I started with NIAS framework, but my contention was that this framework is applicable to all other schools also. Because whenever you are trying to do PhD or trying to do research, the idea should be to frame some doubts. And you should go in that direction, how you could remove that doubt. And if there are different options available, any one option I think you will reach at. And if there are tarkas which are removing, negating one position, another position will be settled. So beginning from, and here again when Gautam is stating these tattvas, he is making that there are only these 12 pramayas, and later philosophers, later nayayikas and scholars raised the question how there could be only 12 pramayas, there are so many pramayas. These 12 he counted only to inquire about. So this could be framed in any cases also. So that was my point. Thank you.
Okay, I think we will here, Professor Sreekumar has to catch a flight. Okay. So we will leave him here and we continue.
Meet me again.
Continue the discussion. Thank you, Professor Sreekumar, for being here for 5 days, and just his 5 minutes of listening to him gave a lot of clarity and encompassiveness. So we will remember your words for the rest of the discussion. Yes. And we look forward to seeing you again very soon. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
This has always been striking my mind. It's always been hindering my mind behind. So the question is, we've discussed about what is the aim. Like when we start off with a study, what is the purpose of the study? Now the question goes to end of the study. What is the implication of philosophy? Now when I take one particular school of philosophy and study, what is the implication that we are trying to look from the study? If you could...
Actually, the aim of philosophy is actually in Indian context is removing the ignorance. You have to remove the ignorance. You have to know the truth. Like when the case I discussed, Gautama. When Gautama explained and propounded this philosophy, 16 tattvas and 12 pramayas. So there is doubt, there are many positions, whether Atman is different from body, whether Atman is identical with body, and whether Atman is a name or not, whether Atman exists or not. So there are different questions, different types of doubts. And removing those doubts is actually removing the ignorance. Because there are different types of ignorances and those should be removed. So this is the purpose of inquiry. And you can formulate in different streams, different purposes. When you are formulate a topic in psychology, different approaches could be there. Different prayojanas, aims could be there. So that is the point.
Please remember that it's not only questions. You can make your own perceptions. You know, sometimes when we ask question, we give the entire responsibility to finding the answer to the person who has to respond. No, I would think that the person who asks the question has the primary responsibility to find an answer, right? So otherwise, again, there's a huge amount of detachment which builds up, which I see often. You ask a question, then you don't even listen what the other person is saying, because you have done your job, right? So that should not be. So I'm not saying that we are doing that, but sometimes it happens. So you, who wanted Suganya or Amrita, right? You wanted a question? Yeah, somewhat a question, but give us somewhat an answer also.
Thank you so much for giving us a methodology on various approaches to begin a research also. So my doubt or something is like similar when we are taking a text called Dvanya Loka, which analyzes a text or on poetry, and then can we take up an, a philosophical approach like Nyaya to analyze those texts, which is actually written on poetry or the giving a theoretical background for poetry, but can we take a philosophical approach as sir has mentioned about Nyaya for analyzing those texts?
Yeah, though, before he answers, perhaps I would also request Dr. Shankar to make the first response, because he already cautioned that analysis of poetry will not lead to enjoyment.
The text called Dvanya Loka has concepts as well as examples. So those examples are from poetry. So, and the concepts are tested based on the analysis of the poetic verses. So, I am not very sure if that analysis will actually, it might add something to the intellect, but not to the experience, probably. Though it has been, there's tradition of the Nyaya scholar, at least Mahima Bhatta, using Nyaya methodology to refute Dvani and say that Dvani is nothing but an instance of Anumana. And then you also have Jagannath Pandita from the 17th century, who uses Navya Nyaya terminologies to analyze certain poetic concepts, basically figures of speech. What he basically does is to refine the definitions. For example, there is a particular definition for what is a simile, what is a metaphor, what is a hyperbole, etc. And his intention is basically to refine these definitions. Does that refinement of definition, will a person enjoy a particular instance of simile much more by refining the definition of what is simile? So that I don't think will happen. So if you define metaphor much more in more precise terms, will a particular poem which has metaphor appeal to you much more? That might not happen.
This is a good question, and Dr. Shankar Rajaraman answered very beautifully. The point is that the analysis of those definitions will not aid to our experience to enjoyment of that poetry. Because when it is said, who enjoys poetry? Only Sahridaya. And being Sahridaya is something different from being an Ayayika. Because when you analyze, it is something different. You are not going to, like a doctor. When doctor operates, he doesn't enjoys, he doesn't like the beauty of the person, but the other person likes. So that is a different, these are two different things. But the point you asked, if it is possible to analyze Dvanya Lok taking the Nyaya methodology, I say yes, it is possible and it is done. And Dr. Azhar Shankar Rajaraman suggested the name of Rasagangadharkar, Mahima Bhatt, Vyakti Vyakti Viveka, and Jagannath, Panditara Jagannath did this work very beautifully. And what I suggested you, when you begin with a doubt and reach at a conclusion, and thereafter could rise another doubt, and there could begin another inquiry. And in this way, there could be an analysis at a deeper level. And in this way, there are many parishkaras which are carried on. So there is always a possibility, such type of possibility. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Mishra. I think what we'll do now is we'll take a few questions and a few comments or a few thoughts together, and then have, you know, this side to respond. So because we want to hear the other side too, because then only the philosophical inquiry is complete. And as I said, you know, this table doesn't mean that we have all the answers, and those two tables means that there are all the questions. No.
Okay. Thank you for the really nice discussion, and I have. In fact, I have been struggling the initial and in fact now as well with methodology, what should be the right methodology. And my field is, of course, sociology and anthropology. And I think methodology is very, very important there. So one of the problems that happened during the early years when we started doing scientific research in India is like how India was perceived by others, like many, like John Stuart Mill or Karl Marx or you know, even many others, though did not, many of them did not even come to India, but they kind of conceptualized, and then that we started reading. And we started also believing in that, that we are like that. And then later critique of, like, especially of Dumont by Srinivas and André Bettelé, later they critique those theories. And so therefore, this hold a whole book view versus the field view. So where Dr. Sreekumar was talking about that how, you know, it is important for, it was important for Socrates to go and in the marketplace or in Delhi, I mean, every day. So which we can call that everyday, you know, philosophy or, and through that probably we understand the world better. So one of the problem was, of course, that, you know, this book view or the theories that sometimes many of the Marxist or feminist and many other groups became victims of, or I wouldn't say victims, rather, you know, they entangled themselves into a lot of problem because of that, because they started believing in so much of one theory, and that they, all the questions determined by that philosophy or that kind of, you know, Marxist way, looking at the world completely materialistic way, or looking at the way completely from, you know, sexuality or gender perspective. So then, of course, the field view is like where, now what should be the field view? I think it's, of course, it has to be dialogical, like where we engage with the participants, understand their view and what exactly is happening. But I do not know whether exactly we can understand the experience that they experience, whether in terms of the, you know, whether that is possible, but and whether we can transcend that kind of, you know, how a person experience something, then you know, how does he or she do that? So I do not know whether that is possible, but what is possible is construction of a common reality and working on that, like hunger is a reality, for example, and how different people, you know, kind of deal with it, or as an institution, what is the experience of institutions, rather what is the you know, hurdles to, for example, school as an institution, how do I go to school and what are the problems I face going to the school. So, and this theory has, of course, not you know, not been kind of eliminated, this kind of book view, because Sundar Saruka and Gopal Guru has written about it, that how certain people philosophize, like they become the theoretical Brahmins, and then the others become empirical Shudras. So others become the data, and the others, there are others sitting in Delhi probably, kind of theorizing on the basis of those data. So how that is also, you know, problem. So then there comes the question of freedom. I think, can we absolutely experience, like what a, being a woman or being a Dalit, what a person experiences, can I as a tool or as a, you know, as someone who is going to understand that field, can we do that? I think it's impossible. So therefore, it is, you know, collaboration or dialogical, again, it has to be, where we agree that they also know, in fact, more than what I know, they are, you know, about their own lives and everything. So I think this is very important, as, you know, that how do we understand the other, or through dialogue, like what I perceive and what that person perceives. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Subrata, for very nicely putting that divide and how we may have to transcend that divide, still engage in understanding. Anybody else wants to talk or want to make a few comments? Yes, Meera.
It's more of a musing.
More of what?
A musing.
Musing. Okay. Yeah. I heard music.
So, yeah. No, musing. So, I was wondering if belief arises.
Keep it a little closer to the microphone. Yeah.
I was wondering what role belief plays in the whole process of critical thinking. Does belief start at the cessation of critical thinking, or is it possible to have belief while you are in the process of critical thinking? Does critical thinking mean that you cannot ever believe in anything, or does your belief get stronger because you keep contemplating on something and your belief is backed by whatever rational ideas that you bring to your belief? Or does it mean that at any point, at any given point, you might not be able to believe in anything because your critical confusions or critical queries keep disturbing you? So where and how does these two intersect?
So what's your approach to it?
we have
to approach an answer also, because otherwise, again, what you said as, you know, the we don't want to be the so-called class and interpreting or answering your, we have to jointly find the answer.
Yeah, it's amusing, ma'am, which is
it's
not
amusing.
A question.
It's so amusing,
I'm,
right?
No, it's amusing. I'm okay. Just thinking about it.
Yeah,
it's not a question.
You know, that's true. Yeah. I don't see the question mark, but still it's amusing. We can still respond to that.
Yeah, so...
No, we have to also see, there is this concept of manana in Upanishad, which is a reflective thinking. When there is a question, not an answer, but a response should go parallelly below it. That is called holistic thinking. That is called, to me, critical thinking. Critical thinking is not having a unsettling question. Perhaps critical thinking is an unsettling question. Why? Because we have to find an answer. It is very settling, you know, when another person has to find an answer. Because then you are settled after you question, right? That is what is happening in the society today. So, but may I request somebody else to respond to that question from that part of the space? Who will respond? You understood the question, right? Basically what she is... I hope you will also think about it, Meera. It's important to respond to that. The relation between belief and critical inquiry or critical questioning, and perhaps also what is the role of disbelief in the whole enterprise, you know? What is the phenomenon of belief? So I guess I don't have to reinterpret a question, but this is just to give a few minutes for you to think about a response. Yes, Niharika wants to answer? Okay, respond, okay.
I might be highly wrong when I make the statement, but behind every theory or behind even an hypothesis, there is a belief. You think that, oh, this might be it, and then there are doubts, or there are doubt of the opposition also, that this is completely wrong. Or like you said, that you have a belief and then you build on it and you find evidence to support your thing. So I think a line of belief is required even for an inquiry. Like when, like Sreekumar sir was referring that, you know, the mirror turns and you are inquiring towards yourself. There's a critical inquiry about yourself. So there's still a belief inside, okay, this is what I'm questioning. So I think in the baseline of even a thought, there is a belief for me. I think I might be highly wrong, like someone might have a really opposite view, but for me, I think it's like a belief should be there. That's why you're questioning. That's why a doubt even arises. That's why the debate for me starts. If you're not believing in something, how can the questions be there? How can you critique it, or how can the other things be possible?
I think what Paha is pointing to is also the ontological nature of belief, or perhaps that you cannot, belief is not just an epistemological process, I would think, because it also has a deep connection with what you are. Perhaps that's what she said. You can't even begin the inquiry if you don't have a belief. So I think that...
Yeah, surely.
So without without some belief, and also I think without an engaging person, a person which is engages, how can you have? Because most of the time we believe as an epistemological entity, which I feel that has to be analyzed. You wanted to make a response to that, Meera? I think you want to say something. Yeah, please use the microphone.
I was wondering if the belief was more in your question rather than in the answers that you arrive at, in the sense that you start to focus on your belief in the question that you are asking rather than, you know, the many answers that you find. Maybe that is one way of going about it, because critical thinking would require you to keep faith in your question so that you go on building on it.
Yeah, absolutely, you are right. But the only problem is the periphery of that question is always falling down. You know, it's always breaking. If it doesn't break, then we are not asking a question. We are only making a statement which looks like a question, right? You have a kind of an obsessive hold on that question, which you think is also a response. Otherwise, you have to consider the question whose periphery is always dropping down. Just visually think about it, right? You have a question, but its periphery is always holding down. So you have to construct new peripheries just to hold on to it, or to have it in one piece. Yeah, I think I'll request Professor Nitin to make a point. Perhaps what is the role of hypothesis in belief? Is hypothesis a belief?
Yeah, so the short answer is, Niharika, you're correct. I'll give the long answer now. So we have to, at least from a mathematical point of view, we have to distinguish between hypothesis, conjecture and axioms. They're very, very different. So conjectures and hypotheses are statements about which we don't know the truth about them. But they all exist in some framework, whereas axioms are the starting point. So in some sense here, probably belief is more closer to an axiom, I would say. It again depends, you know, sometimes it could be an axiom or it could be a conjecture. So conjecture is something where, I'll give an example. Let's say that we make the point that the sum of the angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. It's a conjecture, it could be a conjecture. But what is very interesting is that the answer of that actually depends on an axiom. If you change that axiom, the answer is actually different. So you get Euclidean geometry, you get non-Euclidean geometry. So what I'm asking is, the conjecture, the hypothesis actually rests upon axioms, the deepest down, you know. And the axioms in some sense are taken to be true based on experiential evidence or some reasonability or whatever. So I don't know where do you want to place the belief, at what level. Do you want to place at the level of axiom? Because typically axioms are not questioned, you know. Axioms are questioned only when there is supernatural or whatever, something which is beyond. Like, for example, the orbit of Mercury, you know, when the orbit of Mercury was, we couldn't predict it properly, then people said, oh, something is wrong with Newton's axioms. That's when Einstein came with the new axiom. So we usually don't question axioms unless and until we are forced to change it. Whereas hypothesis is about, okay, does smoking cause cancer, whatever. You can have different hypotheses, and you don't change axioms because, you know, you'll just study the phenomenon, get more evidence, do experiments. So they're very different. Axioms and hypothesis are at a very different level, you know. And you need an overwhelming amount of evidence to change your axioms. To say that the sum of the angles of a triangle is greater than 180 degrees, you're actually changing an axiom. You're coming with a different axiom. It's called the parallel postulate axiom. So this is very, it's very important to look at the level at which you are doing the inquiry. That's the point that's in mathematics. So I don't know how whether it's true in.
I think there is one important thing here, that belief is one, and your questions are also coming from beliefs, right? Whatever questions they are, like our questions are. And I think we can go also that how our beliefs are made in the first place. I mean, is it coming from our experiences, in what context, or what belief? I think that is also very important. And in fact, there, I think the methodology, maybe our beliefs come from common sense, which is, everyday common sense, and we come then. And the scientific query, we might take it, depending on the merit of that belief, we might take it as a, you know, whether it's important as a scientific inquiry, or, you know, that could be one aspect of it. But I think also where the belief is coming from, as Professor Sreekumar was mentioning, the prejudice, you know, what are our prejudices? So I think, in fact, in Buddhist teaching, Buddha said that, you know, whatever I'm saying is just a vehicle. It's just pointing to the moon. It's not the moon. So basically, I think that whatever belief we have, and then our methodology comes, and we are trying to, like, take them towards critical, and we may I mean, that is hypothesis, and we may find it valid or invalid. I don't know. I mean, that is different. But I think since we are talking about methodology, therefore this critical aspect of that is just a vehicle. It is not the, you know, end itself. Yeah. Thank you.
Talk about Sugani. You want to say something from the field? From the field. Yes.
Thank you for giving a wonderful opportunity to take part in this program. In anthropological point of view, I can tell it as a how we can connect myth and belief. For example, during the time of Ebola, we used to heard that for eradicating the virus, we have to burn the body. But according to that community belief, they can't burn. They have to be bury the body. So in that point of view, there are so many anthropological studies have been done during the time of Ebola. So then in the point of view of doctors, how we can tell? For them, for the sake of society, the body should be burned. But in the point of view of community, it should be buried. So they decide to that for in-depth bury, they used to do. Like that, in that situation, how we can think like a critic? I'm just asking in the community point of view. Because according to the definition of Taylor, the culture itself is the study of belief, knowledge system, and etc. So when it's coming to the point of community, how we can critique?
Important question. Actually, I don't have an answer. I don't know. You want to respond?
No, I am just saying my opinion because during my degree period, that time only I used to sit in the class of philosophy. It's like a philosophy education. After that, so many years. Now I'm sitting in this philosophy. Yeah. So I'm just asking how we can be critique in that situation.
No, I think basically a question anybody can respond, or we can jointly respond, that how do we understand critical inquiry, what we have just discussed, particularly in the context of belief, what you have just said, in the space of communities, in community spaces. How do we do that, right? What should be, I just don't have an answer. I don't know whether you want to respond to that.
For example, origin of the community, origin of the world, origin of the living system. Yeah.
So how do we basically educate? Because they are already educated using the tools of mythologies, which are very valid for them.
Yes.
So bringing in the tools of science or you know, practices of proper health regime, how do we still engage with it? It's not very easy, right? You want to say something?
So, I mean, I can just give one example.
Yeah.
I don't know if I have understood your questions properly, but I think what happens, what is in the community context, for example, the Adivasis, that area that I work in, and they for a long time believed about, they are always told that, you know, your culture, you are uncivilized. Many people came and told them that you are uncivilized, and over a period of time, they have probably started believing that they are not enough, ready for the world. Now, many of them got educated over a period of time. Many of them got educated through different, you know, channels. Now, what they are doing, I see that they are bringing science to assert themselves. They are saying, look, your money has not, you know, you have not been able to solve your problems through money and other means that you have adopted the modern scientific world. Look at us, we are protecting the nature. We are, and they're bringing different things. For example, they are saying that, you know, that how they keep a skull in the field. So what they say that that it was a superstition. Like that, so that was the belief. But what they say now, that what earlier what used to happen, that in those areas there are a lot of rats in the field. So what happens, there is a particular animal, which I've forgotten the name, which eats those rats. What it does, it comes and identifies that spot in a dark night, seeing that skull which is white, so it reflects light. So those, that animal particularly comes there or keeps its food there, and then it kind of, you know. So another belief is that many of them, they believe in totemism. Totemism is, you know, so for example, someone believes in many totemism, one group, and I have found many among the Gonds, that one totem is, someone's totem is Naga, or someone's totem, like which is snake. Some animals. So that particular group, they would not eat or harm any snake. The other group may have, but this particular group will not. Similarly, others have, you know, tortoise as their totem. So these were all considered at one point of time that these are very wrong kind of beliefs. Now, in this present context, what they say that at least we are, you know, limiting our consumerism to a great extent, that we are saying that, you know, this particular, we protect particular animal, and that has, we have been doing since time immemorial. Like we particularly take responsibility to protect snakes or protect tortoise, which even others, when they are trying to harm it, we go and protect it. So there is, and here you are trying to teach that through school. And so they are now also bringing this, the idea of science, and it to invoke, they are invoking basically science to assert their own beliefs and everything. So I think it's, I don't know if it has answered, but this is how it is.
I think once we start discussing belief in the context of critical inquiry, it gets, we understand that it is not just a black and white, there are lots of gray shades, and we may not have all the answers too. And that is why it's very important to at least be aware of it, because most of the time we take the view and consider the view to be employed in all our enterprises. So that the has to be replaced with a, you know. So anybody else wants to?
Just to add on.
Yes, please.
I don't know whether it captures, but this is also my inquiry. I think Subarto can also throw light on this, that I'm not sure that value judgment is the task of ethnographer. So give the value judgment to community, or his job is more about the descriptive of analyzing, because most of the time when you giving the evaluating, so that also required the framework comparison. So I'm not sure that how much ethnographer is kind of that is within the scope of his study. Is it, that's what I want to know.
Inquiry, we always try to figure out the answer first or give a theory first, and then the beliefs come. Like Sir was saying about that Newton gave some axioms, we believed in that, and then you know, we pushed towards the limit, oh, this is wrong. Then the new axioms came and new belief system came about. But in communities, or that we see in our daily lives, there's a belief first, and then we try to support our beliefs with, you know, with maybe some conjectures, maybe with some theories. So there's a different approaches you see. Like, you know, in scientific, it's always theory, then belief, then faith. Here it's faith first and then, you know, supporting the faith.
So there's a difference. I think Dr. Saurabh brought a very important point of value judgment, which sometimes we, you know, don't take it that seriously, which also I think we are making a lot of judgments, value judgments, without even knowing that we are making that, because we think that there is the right way to do, one right way to do things. So I'm getting a lot of, you know, nice feeling of silence from this side. So maybe I should not be too much pampered with that silence. So may I request you to just disturb me with a few questions or comments?
Thank you, sir and ma'am, and everyone for the wonderful discussion. See, would like to highlight something about the purpose of philosophy. I have a very limited understanding about philosophy. So first of all, why do we have questions? So this is my take on it. So let's take, see, we all have a certain worldview, and we all have certain beliefs and assumptions, which we ourselves don't know. And to certain extent, we are happy about the beliefs and our assumptions. But at some point, we get a contradiction from the world, from the world, and we get suffering. So at that point of time, we start thinking, oh, what is wrong with my model, or what is wrong with my assumption? So I think
belief, regarding the belief that you asked, right? So there is some inherent belief that we all are carrying out. But when do we find out that belief? When we get contradictions from the world around us. So that time we start asking questions. Because why? What if we don't ask questions? Then we'll be in suffering. So I think one of the important goals of philosophy is to remove suffering. And happiness plays a key role. I think so. This is my take on it.
Thank you. Thank you, Hari. I've heard Hari, though being a mathematician, using the word suffering as many in my earlier discussions also. So for him, it is both an epistemological entity and an entity which teleological, because we have to remove it, as we go on. So I always try to understand, how his mind is framing that idea of suffering, which is, I feel, it is very complex and nuanced. It is not just the suffering which we might popularly understand. Anybody else wants to talk about? Abhishek? No? No. Anybody else? No? I feel it's extremely important that our mind has to exercise to talk about. Because we are big talkers, right? We talk all the time. The idea of philosophy is to have that big talking channelized through small talking. And the small talking is what's happening now. Because you can only talk about small things. You cannot talk about big things. And philosophy helps us to, divide or analyze the big things into small and then look into it to give an insight and to perhaps that share that understanding to a larger folk. So it's extremely, I feel, important that philosophy helps us to engage. If we felt in the last 1.5 hours a lot of detachment, from what was being discussed, an inability to participate, then seriously we have to look into our mind. Because today's society is producing, please pardon me for saying this, very specialized exemplaries. You're very specialized in one thing, you're very exemplary in that, but then you don't know what's happening around you. We cannot live in that world anymore, because the world which we live in is day in and day out beckoning us to look around. And I feel a lot of things which we see happening around in today's society is because we are not looking around. We are just enclosed in oneself, in our own so-called technical space, and not able to extend our space to others. And philosophy endorses detachment. Philosophy endorses detachment, the ability to not to be perturbed, and not to be even provoked by what's around. And I feel sometimes in that way philosophy is practiced many times. I see a lot of people not being perturbed, not being provoked, No, that is not philosophy. Philosophy is the ability to engage with what's happening around. And if you are not engaging with it, it's extremely important that we have to reflect our own mind. Because that is the right point, we have to reflect our own mind. Because that is indicating something. That even without your agency, without your intention, we are just occupying a space without engaging. Because philosophy is all about our daily life. Philosophy is all about how we live, how we question, how do we understand others, how do we respect a view which is not of agreement, in agreement to what we hold. So I sometimes think that philosophy is the best practice which allows us to coexist with mutual respect. So anybody wants to say something? It's not saying something, it is, earlier when we were students, that's a long time back, a notebook and a pen is extremely important. Nowadays I say a letterhead and pen. But they also are very detached. Nothing happens with the pen, nothing happens with the note. Nobody writes notes. The pen is sitting there, the notebook is sitting there. So everything is detached in today's world. But then they all are there. Notebook is there, pen is there, you are there, your hand is there, your finger is there. Nothing happens. So we are living in a world which is maximizing and celebrating alienation in spite of everything being around us. I feel there should be a change in that. And that is the whole goal of philosophy, that it provokes us to engage, participate. And if we are not participating, we have to question ourselves. And I think we have to, best place to begin with is classroom. The best place to begin with is classroom.
Participating in what way? Is it the moderator to be engaged with the world? Is it just wondering on what is happening?
No, not the world. Participating in, first of all, being with the present. Engagement itself means being with the present. When we are overwhelmed, when we are engulfed with a lot of other self-centered thinking, you are not in participating with the rest of it. You are not engaging then. You are only being inside more and more. That is not the going inward which is suggested by philosophy. At least some of the contemplative practices in philosophy, going inward is actually by going outward and realizing that the division of outward and inward was actually created by you or is being created by you every moment. Because we give reality to the outward inward, right? That is why the tendency to go inward in a sense of not really going inward, but only being enclosed and shut down in your own little spaces. So participating is actually being in the present. The only way we can participate is by being in the present. Otherwise, things happen and go, and we don't realize what's happening in front of us. So, anybody else wants to say something?
Can I add to
it? Yes, please.
So, Harish, actually, I'm very touched by your question in the sense because it has captured in the sense of what we say the essence of phenomenology in Heidegger at least. So, because Heidegger interestingly says about that his problem, because I'm coming to what you have said, so I thought that is remarkable similarity, what you have said about the suffering and all that and as the aim of philosophy. He says that our present, how we engage in the world. So his answer is that our fundamental engagement in the world, which he calls as the comportment, in the terms of the tools that we engage with the world in the terms of the tool. So my foremost engagement with this mic is that because I am using it. So it is more pragmatic engagement. And thereafter, there is when it doesn't work, then there is a theoretical engagement. So he says that in some moments what happens, this comportment breaks down. So I see the world. So he gives the example of the death of some beloved person or some deep suffering. Then I cannot engage with the world in the same way I was using, either as he says in the pragmatic term, which he calls as the ready to hand, or in the theoretical terms, which he calls as the present at hand. It's there, but I could not engage with it. So what is there at me? So he says that in this moment, the anxiety is produced. So this is not a psychological thing. He says anxiety is very fundamental thing. In the sense, he says, we try to run away from that anxiety. So he beautifully says that in the fear, we run from the things, but in anxiety, we turn towards the things. Because in order to dispel that anxiety, we start to use something so that we can again get busy in our normal things. So he says authenticity, as you are saying, so authenticity is that when you become resolute for this moment and you ask the question. So for him, this philosophical notion of asking the question is something, as Professor Sangeetha Menon was saying, that it is something very authentic, it is a part of your being. So it is not something you can outsource your responsibility to some other person, because that is something which will keep you engaged. So that's what I had in the mind.
Anybody else wants to say something? Usually in the panel discussion, we say, after all, then final words of wisdom from the panelists. I don't want to do that, really, because it has to be very participatory and engaging. And even in this way, we don't want to create hierarchies, because sometimes knowledge production itself becomes a space for creating hierarchies, that who creates knowledge, who receives it, and then who certifies it. So the production of knowledge itself has to be very participatory and contributory and constructive. It cannot come just from one side. Anybody else wants to, talk about what we are discussing or say something else, or otherwise we'll slowly move towards winding up. No? Then Dr. Shankar, you wish to, then I will ask Professor Mishra to perhaps respond. Okay, I'll give you a question if that helps you. Perhaps respond to some of the queries which we all raised together, and to begin with, some of the descriptions which we made about critical inquiry to begin with. So, for example, what Professor Sreekumar said, it was tracing the evolutionary history of critical inquiry itself. And at some point, he talked about, how one particular tradition talks about the prejudice of prejudice itself. So, and of course, you talked about poetry, and Professor Mishra talked about the Nayayika approach of critical inquiry. So, and of course, you brought in a different aspect altogether by looking at poetry, which is not thinking per se, but enjoying, right? So, what is the goal of critical inquiry? And I think I wish to come back to what Dr. Saurabh said, which I also personally feel is important. What is the goal of your critical inquiry? Because without that question, can we decide in what way we move forward? Is that too much philosophical? Then, you can bring in the context of poetry and,
I think I need to bring the context of poetry.
Sure.
So, in a way, poetry helps you to escape from the hegemony of critical thinking.
Right.
So, critical thinking, I think, could come only after you have had an experience. And critical thinking would basically help you to illumine the experience to an extent, but it may not add anything extra to the experience. So that is the point that I wanted to make through my few minutes of talk also, yeah. That I'm a person who would like to experience rather than question the experience.
Sure.
So in a way, even the traditionally also, the poets have regarded Nayayikas as, in a way, their enemies. So both Nayayikas and Vaiyakaranas, the grammarians as well as logicians, have been regarded as enemies of poets. And many, many times they have criticized the approach of Nayayikas. So maybe that is because they question experience too much and finally prevent us from, they do not authenticize our experience at all. And they say that it is not possible that you could have had such an experience. So that is something too much to bear for us. So,
yes.
It was a nice experience to be a part of this discussion. Really, there are some questions and some questions are answered. There was one question which I was asked about belief. So when we begin with, and there professor intervened and gave very important insight, axiom, conjecture, hypothesis, and he made a distinction between them. But taking apart all these terms, if we study the idea from a commonsensical perspective, the common man doesn't make such distinctions. What is axiom, what is conjecture, and what is hypothesis? He takes it simply as a belief, okay? So when you begin with a belief and critically evaluating it, this is true that you come with, and if the belief passes that inquiry, in that case, you come with a greater conviction that this belief is truer. In Nyaya, it is called Nishkampa Pravritti. So in that case, because this is the same, with a conviction you say that this is the same, this is true. And many times it happens that a belief turns out to be an axiom because you never question it that. Thereafter, if some questions are unsettling questions are coming, then only it is taken aback.
it is revised. So this is happening here. And what about Dr. Shankar Rajaraman made a very simple and very crucial statement regarding experience and analysis of experience. Actually, when you talk about experience as a poet or as an alankarik talks about this, they bring in it so many things which are very mysterious. And the Nayayikas are very much unsettled with those mysterious things. Therefore, there is a very long tradition of rejection of Vyanjanavritti in Nyaya tradition. Because what is this Vyanjanavritti and how could it operate? The Nayayikas never understand. So, this is the point. So here, when you discuss this and another point is there, when you are experiencing, you are not adding any new knowledge to your stock of knowledge. Actually, what you are experiencing, that you have taken for granted and you are enjoying it. So these are two different domains. And I think Abhinav Gupta was the philosopher who took these two domains together. He wrote on Dhanyalok also, and he propounded a philosophy also. And if you, in this background, if you try to understand that philosophy, I think you can have a deeper understanding.
So I think we have had a very detailed discussion on this, touching many disciplines. But, you know, he almost raised a topic, but that might take another 1.5 hours. We won't start with it. He said that's not how a common man thinks. So it's extremely important how a common person thinks. What is the method of thinking? For example, we talk a lot about consequential thinking today. And you don't have to be educated or technically qualified in one particular discipline. Consequential thinking is the ability to perhaps exactly distinguish between all that four factors which you just said, you know. So I sometimes feel that distinction need not even be a part of your technical expertise, but it is common wisdom. That is what called a common person's wisdom. You may not be educated in a particular field, but a good decision maker, someone who is able to make let's say approximate and optimal discussions by taking calculated risk is able to distinguish between the levels of belief in terms of, I think, what Professor Nitin said. So I would agree with him in that sense. You may not have those words, but the formulation is, the essence of what you said is there. Because that is how we all think about consequences, right? When we think, we also think about consequences. Particularly when we transform what we think into an act. So, and that is where a lot of risk comes in decision making. And most of the decision making actually involves a lot of risk. If you just reflect a little bit on the whole phenomenon of how we make decisions on the small amount of information we have and how we deal with the consequences, we will be very appreciative about ourselves. Because the amount of risk in each decision making is so much, we're just not aware of it so consciously, but it's all there. So that's where we also talk about in terms of risk aversion. I mean, this topic is not on risk, but what I was just thinking is we all have a holistic perception of the problem at hand. And therefore, we also engage in how much you can believe, how much you can trust what is in front and what is not in a front. And then we make calculations and accordingly we act. So again, I just want to bring our minds to that question which was raised again. What is the goal for which we want to adopt a particular inquiry? What is that goal? Because we all have our own individual goals, which we have designed, which we have fashioned, which we have thought about in a particular manner. For that, what is the method we would like to adopt? With that question, we will end this discussion. Thank you very much.